Yaskawa.
Welcome to this Yaskawa eLearn video. I'm Paul Avery. This presentation is part of a series of videos demonstrating the ease of integrating Yaskawa Variable Frequency Drives, or VFDs, onto a Rockwell Automation PLC using the Rockwell software. This presentation will cover how to connect a Yaskawa VFD to a typical Rockwell Automation PLC. In our case, we will be using a Rockwell Automation Compact Logics PLC, but the same steps will apply if you have a Control Logics PLC. In this video, we will cover what hardware and software is required, how to configure the VFD to connect and be controlled by the Rockwell PLC, how to add our VFD as a node on the Ethernet IP network, and how to download the configuration to the PLC and check that there are no errors. Our three main hardware components necessary for this demonstration will be the Yaskawa A1000 VFD, our laptop with Logic Designer, previously RS Logics 5000, and the Rockwell PLC. First thing we'll need to do is make sure that the VFD and PLC are connected on the same network. This could mean a direct connection between the VFD and PLC via the same switch, or a series of switches connected to each other. Now let's get the devices powered up. Now that the devices are powered up, the first thing you'll need to do with the VFD is to program its network settings. Per ODVA, the default mode of the drive is to use DHCP to get its network settings. If you're not using DHCP, then you'll need to program the settings by hand. Using the keypad or DriveWizard software, set the option card's IP address, which we'll set to 192.168.1.20 for this demonstration. Repeat the steps for subnet mask and gateway if needed. Lastly, to make sure we get the programmed IP we set, change parameter F7-13 to 0, and then cycle power to the VFD. To confirm our addresses have taken, we can use monitor U6-80 through U6-91 to check the values. The values will show as long as the option card is connected to another device via its Ethernet cable, which in our case is the PLC. Also, the network status LED on the option card should now glow a steady green. One last thing before we move on to the PLC. If you plan on controlling the VFD using the PLC versus monitoring only, you'll need to configure the A1000 to look for the run and reference commands from the Ethernet IP option board. To do this, we will need to set parameters B101 and B102 to a setting of 3, which is option printed circuit board. There is no need to cycle power to the VFD after this adjustment. Now let's move on to configuring the PLC so that it can start communicating to the VFD. To do this, we'll need to use our Logics Designer software. We're going to assume that you have a project started and that your PLC is configured minus the VFD. Find the Ethernet icon under the controller organizer on the left side. Right-click on that icon and select New Module. It will bring up a list of devices that can be added to the PLC. If we wished, we could import the EDS files for our A1000, and then our A1000 would be included on the list of things to add to the PLC. Rather, we will add our VFD to the network as a generic Ethernet module. That way, if later we want to replace the VFD with a different size or different generation of drive, we will not have to change anything provided we use the same IP address and assemblies. Once we select generic Ethernet module, a new module properties window will pop up. There are 7 steps to configuring the generic module. 1. Name your module. The name will show up on the controller navigation. 2. Change the communication format from a double integer to a single integer. 3. Input the IP address of your SIEN3 option card. In our case, we programmed the drive to 192.168.1.20. 4. Change the input assembly to your desired assembly. Please refer to the Ethernet IP manual for a list of available assemblies. For this demonstration, we are going to use assembly 71, which is a 4-byte or 2-word assembly. We'll change the size of the assembly to 2, since the size adjustment is in terms of a 16-bit word and not an 8-bit byte. For step 5, we repeat the input assembly setup, except on the output assembly. For our demonstration, we will use assembly 21, which has a size of 2 words. Step 6 is to simply set the configuration number to 1 and then click OK. The 7th and final step will involve changing the RPI, or requested packet interval time. It is recommended to use 100 milliseconds to reduce the amount of processing required from the PLC. Ultimately, the more often the PLC has to send and receive messages, the faster it has to work. But the faster something is done, like stamping office paperwork, the more likely it becomes that an error will be made. Now that we have created our VFD as a generic Ethernet module on the PLC, we will need to download this configuration to the PLC itself. If there are no errors during the download, then you can put the controller into the run mode. If there are no configuration or communication errors between the PLC and VFD, the status will read IO OK. Otherwise, you'll get a yellow triangle with an exclamation point in it next to the drive, and the status will read IO not responding. Please refer to the error code generated to help troubleshoot this situation. I hope you enjoyed this e-learning video. If you found this useful, please check out the other videos in this series using the tag generator, importing and using Yaskawa add-on instructions, or AOIs, and importing and using the Yaskawa faceplates.